Hello everyone, my name is Ricardo Villalobos.
And I'm David McEgan.
We are Senior Cloud Architects with the Windows Azure Incubation Team, part of DPE.
And this is part two of our Windows Azure Open Platform series.
In this specific episode, we're going to talk about connectivity and websites in continuation to the PaaS, IIS, and virtual network that we talked about last time. All right, so let's talk about Windows Azure cross-premises connectivity, David. We didn't cover the scenario where you need to access local resources.
And local being in my data center?
In your data center or in your facilities or in some place that is not the data center where Windows Azure is being hosted.
Okay, well, there's a challenge.
Yep, it is. So we have a few options today, right, in the platform. The first one is about data, and we call that service data sync.
Right, so we're able to synchronize data between instances of SQL Server.
Right, but that's only about data and SQL Server, relational data.
Right.
Then we have also a messaging solution that can be used to integrate or connect distributed applications, and that's the service bus.
Right, so we have our service bus, which has a pub-sub model.
Correct.
We also have some other mechanisms like our storage queues and other ways to communicate.
Right, but then we have two of those options at the bottom that we consider part of the connectivity that you will get from an IP level perspective. And that's what we consider the VPN or Windows Azure or VPN portion of the Windows Azure networking.
Mm-hmm.
We have the traditional site-to-site, which is a VPN device to a VPN device in Windows Azure. And what is the second one, David?
We now have point-to-site.
Exactly.
Where you can add an individual machine to a Windows Azure virtual network.
And I think that with these two options, we cover most of these scenarios out there, right? Mm-hmm. When it comes to connecting to local resources. All right, so how do you connect VPN devices, and how many we support today?
It's at least a dozen or two.
Yes, that's
and I know we support quite a bit of the Cisco and Juniper
yes.
VPNs. But even if you didn't have one on the supported list, we're working with partners that are getting their
correct.
VPN boxes working just by following the same configurations.
And the reason for that is the scripts are very standard. There's nothing proprietary about them. We have really well documented those scripts and how you deploy them, right?
Right.
All right, so if you think about it, and if you watch part one of our episodes, you can have a virtual network connecting cloud services, PaaS plus IIS. If you want to keep your data, that's a very common scenario, you want to keep your data on premises, local, what you do is you deploy your PaaS, which is probably going to be a front end. And then you want to connect that with your data being hosted on-premises. It could be a SQL database. It could be a NoSQL database, we're going to talk
right.
about later.
Or it could be legacy hardware that simply
exactly.
cannot be moved to the cloud.
For any reason. Now, the other justification or requirement might be that there's some compliance or some type of sovereignty issue in that country, right? There are specific rules in Canada or Australia.
Right, so now you might have a scenario where you're putting a set of web services in your data center, which your data sits behind.
Correct.
And then your cloud application can reach into the data center through those services.
Yes.
Over the VPN connection.
Yep.
So you're keeping all the data and data processing in your data center and not violating those compliance rules.
There are things to consider like latency and you know the type of connectivity between your locations and Windows Azure, but those are things that we have seen many partners overcome and deploy really nice architecture like this
sure.
one. Excellent. All right. So and obviously the endpoints are going to be connected to your PaaS solution and the resources are going to be securely accessed via that VPN connection.
Right.
Okay. For this demo, I have created a virtual network when I have three different machines. I have a MySQL engine that you can see here, and this is the internal IP address. I have a worker role also where I'm going to have my front end, and I also have a MemSQL machine that I can use for caching purposes. If you can see also, there's a connection created with a gateway that is running locally in a home office. So if I want to log in into my cloud service instance, I can select cloud services right here, and then I will go to the Java task example that I have. If I click on the URL, you're going to have that we have an example of the task application right here. And this is basically getting information from the local virtual machine in the same network. Now, we have a connection string in the configuration where you can see that I'm connected to an internal IP address to retrieve that information right here. I'm going to remote desktop into one of the instances, and actually I already have that open. This is how the instance running on Windows Azure looks like. I can open the MySQL workbench. I can query my MySQL instance running on that specific IP address, internal IP address. And when I query, you're going to see the specific record that is actually showing in the application itself right here. So what I can do now is I can switch my configuration to talk to the internal computer or the local computer that is running in the home office. And the way I configure my virtual machine is going to use this internal IP address, 192.168.1.6. Now I'm going to save my changes. So now that I have changed the IP address, the front end is now pointing to the database that is being hosted in the home office. I have a secure tunnel between the virtual network and the VPN gateway. So if I come to the dashboard again, and I click on the URL, you will notice that now it's retrieving a different record. And if I refresh the other screen that I have, it's going to show the VPN record as well. There you go. Now let me show you how this works internally. I will go back to the remote desktop, and look at this. I'm going to now move to the VPN connection. I'm going to query the table task, and you will see that that's the record that is being stored in the machine in the home office. Also, I can show you that I can connect to that machine directly from this computer. If you remember the diagram that we showed earlier, my web front end can communicate with internal machine running MySQL or with the machine in the home office running MySQL, and it's up to me to decide which one is being accessed. More important, nobody can see those databases from the outside, only my web front end. All right, David, now let's talk about what we have combining PaaS plus IIS plus local resources, and that's what we mean with hybrid architectures. I think that the next diagram is gonna show some of that.
And we talk about this a lot.
Yes.
Where partners really want to build these robust systems.
Correct. So you have your PaaS connectivity with your IIS, as we explained in part one of the presentations. Now, one thing that we didn't mention is when you deploy your virtual network, you can define one of your servers to be the DNS. Because if you remember, when you have multiple virtual machines inside a cloud service, they can see each other by name.
Right.
But when you have multiple cloud services, the only way for them to see each other is by IP address, unless you have what?
Right, so you can define your own DNS space.
Correct.
And now all of your, and you could also bring that DNS that's compatible with your on-premises servers.
Yes.
So now they're all talking to each other via name.
And that's what we're showing here. It's a combination of PaaS plus IaaS plus on-premises machines and resources, very powerful, covering most of the scenarios, right?
Right, and now you've created a secure network.
Yes.
Because no other cloud services can get to the data center resources.
Exactly.
Since they're over that dedicated VPN.
Yes.
And within the virtual network, now all of the machines can talk to each other.
Correct. And obviously, you can just open the endpoints that you want the world to see. The rest remains internal, which is very important from a security point of view.
Right. So your software is still responsible.
Yes.
For some level of security.
Yeah,
where you have a website or web services, but there's no way
from an IT infrastructure to access those resources.
Right, right. There's no reason to have to open up anything from your internal data center.
All right, David, we've been talking about PaaS, IIS, virtual networks, on-premises. What about websites? We mentioned websites in episode one.
Yeah.
We really didn't went deep into that.
Yeah, what about websites? We talked about websites in PaaS. We talked about websites in IaaS, and now we have a service called websites.
Right. So yeah. I think that this slide is really good to clarify what the difference is. If you think about the deployment model, what you are doing is delegating some of the technology stack to your vendor, in this case Microsoft, with Windows right. Azure. With virtual machines, now you have to be in charge of the operating system, the runtime, the data, and the application. When you start using
PaaS,
and all the patches, yep. exactly, and the updates. Now, when you deploy to cloud services, now you are delegating less layers of that technology stack to you.
So what about if I just want to worry about my application
yes.
and data?
Exactly.
That's all I want to focus on.
Exactly. Now, with cloud services, if you think about it, you still have a level of control. You can deploy additional components. You can even modify the registry inside Windows. You can do multiple things with those machines. With websites, you basically are really just concentrated on the application and the data. And the more you move to the right, the less work you have, but also less flexibility, right?
Right, and we should talk about that a little bit.
Yes.
With cloud services, you mentioned registry and,
yes.
and other components being installed. I think that's pretty commonplace for a mm-hmm. lot of applications. Maybe some background processes that are running or special performance counters, COM objects.
Yes.
Anything of that nature is going to require cloud services.
Yes.
Cloud services. But there are websites that are truly standalone web applications that are then contacting some data layer
Correct.
Or data service
yes.
and don't need any customization.
Correct.
And that's really that sweet spot for websites.
So what changes is the deployment model. That's the other way to see it, right? With virtual machines, you have to create your image, either on-premise or in the cloud. You have to install the components. You have to make sure that everything is working before you either create it on the cloud or upload it.
Right.
With cloud services, you create your application, and you create a configuration file, you upload it, and Windows Azure is going to take care of that merge. With websites, the only thing you do is upload your code. And actually, yep. you can work with frameworks like WordPress, Drupal, and other common ones.
Right. We have several frameworks that are built in that you can deploy very,
yes.
very quickly. But what's also nice about websites, and we'll talk about this more when we get into the developer story in a later episode, is the sheer number of ways to deploy the code.
Yes. So let's continue. Now that we understand the different deployment models and what differentiates virtual machines from cloud service to website, is how do you decide which one to use?
And we get this question all the time.
Yes, and it's justifiable, it's understandable, because they share a series of characteristics or features. It's not easy. And so we created this decision tree that hopefully, obviously it's not a generalization, it's difficult to cover every single scenario, but it helps, I think. So the first question, what are the first questions you need to ask, David?
So the first thing we need to ask is, do you even use Linux? And I know this seems strange, we're talking Windows Azure, but we do support Linux in the virtual machines. But even if you're not using Linux, maybe you have to do a complex install.
Right.
We know that you talked about PaaS and how you can script these startup tasks.
Correct.
Well, something like SQL Server is not exactly scriptable, especially
yes.
if you want a scalable environment
Correct.
Where it scripts in only a few, runs in only a few minutes.
Yes.
It may take much longer than that.
So if that's the case and the answer is yes, you require Linux, or you have a complex installation, use virtual machines, right? That's very simple. Now, what happens if that's not the case? Well, the next question you have to ask yourself, are you using a hybrid infrastructure, mm-hmm. meaning that you need to combine multiple cloud services? Do you need to combine PaaS with IaaS? Do you need to connect to on-premise resources or not?
Yep.
That's the next question. If the answer is yes, then what is the solution?
Now you have an option.
Yes.
I mean, you have potentially virtual machines, potentially
yep.
cloud services, but I think you have to take a look at both of them.
Correct.
And you'll look at the different components of your system, and you'll make that decision, and you'll also incorporate networks and VPNs.
Which, this means that if you want to have internal connectivity, you don't consider websites, right? Because websites are going to require an external endpoint in order to talk to those components.
Right. If you are going to build a very simple website,
yes.
but it has to talk to another internal virtual machine,
right.
you'll have to use cloud services.
It's an internal connectivity and secure
right.
Connections, right.
right.
Now, if the answer is no, Then there's another question. Do you require additional components? Do you need to install like a, I don't know, MPEG encoder or something in your app for your application to work? Do you need to remote desktop into these machines because you want to do more things inside of them or monitor or things like that?
Yep.
If the answer is yes, then again, the option is virtual machines or cloud services.
Right.
Now, if you don't require this, if you don't require remote desktops, if you don't require to add any additional components, if you don't require internal connectivity or Linux, then consider websites. And we say consider websites because, you know, again, we cannot cover every single scenario.
And you still may want to use cloud services.
Correct.
But websites gives you this really nice, very highly scalable, managed environment to launch your web application.
Correct. All right, so hopefully this has given you an idea of how to choose your deployment model. To summarize part two, let's start by saying that by having VPN connectivity, you can add on-premises resources to your architectures and cover a lot of the different scenarios.
Yep.
You can also have PaaS or websites for easy management and deployment. Again, you can use that decision tree that we show in order to make that decision.
Right, so combining all this, you really get to create these hybrid architectures.
Great.
And so now you can have fun.
Yeah. All right, David, thank you for the conversation, as always. And thank you for watching.
Yep, thank you very much.